Andrew Argue, CPA, CEO, AccountingTax.com. This is an unprecedented crisis. What do accountants need to do?
Most people are kind of flat-footed. They don't know how to handle it. They don't know what to do. I see a lot of these firms out there going, I've seen dormant. You know, there was a little Facebook group where one of my clients was in. He counted, you know, 26 firms said, well, we're going dormant. We're going dormant. And so they're kind of waving the white flag. They're taking some time off or whatever the case may be. But, you know, I've said this before that when you look at the people that are helping with this whole crisis, obviously the physicians and the nurses are like frontline, right? Because this is like medical crisis. And so they're the real sort of heroes in this. I would say the second group of, you know, important profession would be like therapists, psychologists, because you've got 3 billion people around the world that are on like house arrest. So obviously that's going to create some psychological issues, not to mention they've got the virus chasing after them and all these, they're you know, they're losing their businesses, they're losing their jobs. So, you know, mental health crisis is huge. I've seen that in my own life with a number of different people as well. So you've got health crisis, mental health crisis, but then I think you've got financial crisis, economic crisis, and that's where I think financial professionals, tax and accounting professionals come in. And I think that, you know, the services that you were offering before, tax prep, bookkeeping, or even tax planning CFO, which is what we've been working on for a long time, are important and have a role, but like, what are the things specifically related to this crisis? What are the advisory services that people need right now? And I think a lot of firms are scared because they're like, well, I don't know how to do that. I don't know how to do SBA loans. I don't know how to do the CARES Act and do this. And it's all so new. And I've never done forecasting and cash management. And so they think, I don't know how to do this, therefore I can't help. And the problem with that is like, do you think any of these business owners know what to do when they've dropped sales 90%, they've laid off their people, they've got 3 months until they think the economy reopens, but sales are going to be down 70%. They're receiving some government money. Some of that's in the form of a forgivable loan. Some of that's in a form of a real loan. They've got some fixed expenses. They've got some variable expenses. They've got some savings. They've withdrawn from their retirement. And how are they going to figure that out? And so I think that in order to help someone, you only need to know a little bit more than they do. You don't need to know everything. You don't need to be an expert on everything related to COVID, because by the time you're an expert on everything related to COVID, the whole crisis is going to be over. So you need to know a little bit more than your client. As long as you know a little bit more than your client, you can extend a helping hand and you can move them down the field. And so that's be the first thing. I say, get in the game, help these people. But I say the second one, and then I'll, you know, we can go on to the next one is, and I've been getting a lot of flack for this, but you have to charge your clients in this situation. You have to bill them for something. Now, there are some things you can bill for, some things you can't bill for, and you should do the research on that. We've done a lot of research on that. Be specific in your engagement letters. But I know it's hard because some of these businesses are getting crushed. You don't want to charge them. But the problem is every time you don't charge a client right now, you're sentencing your employees to being fired, laid off, whatever you want to call it, during the coronavirus. And so when I see people saying, oh, you shouldn't be charging business owners, you shouldn't be charging business owners, you know, it's very selfish because you are the owner of the business. You're the accounting firm owner. You know, you've got it. You're doing 200,000 in sales, 500,000 in sales, 1 million, 5 million, 10 million, 20 million, whatever the case may be. You're going to be fine. You've got a business. Even if your sales go down 50%, you're still going to be okay, most likely. And by the way, a lot of you guys' sales are going to go down 40 to 60%. But your employees are not going to make it. They're not going to make it. You will lay them off. And you're already seeing that. Firms across the country laying people off, laying people off, laying people off because they're not charging, they're not pivoting, they're not transitioning, they're not doing advisory services. And so I always say, like, I get it. You feel bad for these business owners, but you've got to charge every business owner that you work with a little bit so that way you can save the jobs of all the employees that you have. And if you're fortunate enough to actually grow your business during this time period, which has happened in many cases because this is like major need for these services, then you probably should hire some people that got fired from other jobs. I mean, don't we need to get some of these people off of the unemployment? How are you going to get people off unemployment if you don't have sales, if you don't have revenue coming in? And so, look, I get it. It feels uncomfortable, but you've got to think about the whole scope. And if we can charge every business owner a little bit and actually provide them value, actually help them through the process, actually stabilize their balance sheet, actually help them get on the other side of this, actually help them recover and save their business, they'll be with you till 2030. You know, most tax accounting firm clients stay 5 to 7 years. These people are 10 years if we get them out of this sucker. But you're also going to save the employees. And so, you know, every day since this thing started, I just think like, you know, how can we stabilize ourselves? It's like that old thing, right? Where, you know, you're in the airplane. Nobody's in airplanes so much anymore, but you're in the airplane. You got to get the mask on yourself before you help your kid, right? So you as a tax accountant, you got to stabilize your own business. You have to figure out a way to get new revenue in, stabilize your own family, your own employees, and then get out there and help as many business owners as we possibly can. And that's what I've been working on ever since this thing started. And I think it requires a new way of thinking. It requires learning new things. And it has been honestly the craziest time period since I've started this business doing this stuff. But it's been also the most rewarding and the most meaningful. And if you don't know that, you haven't been talking to these business owners and actually helping them. Because when you do save them and when they do get a $500,000, you know, disaster loan, or you do help them map out, hey, you didn't get a loan, but here's how you're going to be able to survive it anyway. Or they get a forgivable loan where they don't even need to pay the money back and they can save their employee. I mean, it's just all of these things are like, before, well, the work we were doing was kind of cool, right? Okay, we like it. We're tax accounting. Now it's like, it really means something though. It really means something in a way that it's a survival, it's a life and death of the business situation. And, you know, these people are either going to have no business, go bankrupt. They're going to have no employees, people losing their jobs in the middle. And the worst thing is the coronavirus, you know, it's like if somebody got laid off, that's bad. But if somebody got laid off, then they get locked in their house and the coronavirus is out there to get them. They feel that way, right? It's creepy. It's very creepy. So I've done everything in my power. My main motivation has been my own employees, really. I've got 38 full-time employees and then the employees of the accounting firms and the employees of the business owners, because I think most of the accounting firms are going to be fine. The business owners are screwed, right? The accounting firms are going to be fine. It's the employees of all these firms that are not going to be fine. And you're already seeing that with these firms across the country laying off tons and tons of people.
So what are the first things accountants should be doing with their clients?
So the first thing right now is, you know, before this whole crisis started, if you were doing advisory services, so not just compliance, but you were doing advisory services, a lot of the focus that we would have when we would sit down with a business owner would be, okay, let's sit down with the business owner. Let's understand their business, what they're doing in sales, what they're making in profit, what they're doing in salary, and how can we help this person make more money? Can we do tax planning with them? Can we be a CFO for them? Can we help them grow their business? The problem is now, a lot of the advisory services in the past when the economy was good were on the income statement. Now, though, because we've switched into this sort of survival economy, everything's about the balance sheet. So when you sit down with a business owner, it's all about balance sheet strength. The strength of the balance sheet is going to determine whether or not these people make it out of this thing or not. And a lot of people are not going to make it out of this thing. Even if it ends, you know, the economy reopens relatively shortly, they're not going to make it out. So the first thing you got to figure out is when you go to the balance sheet, where do we stand? You know, like imagine you come across a business right now where they're losing $1,500 a day. They've got $75,000 in cash. They've maxed out credit, and that's what they've got, right? So how do we start to extend it? How do we get them to a point where they can break even on a cash basis? You know, you see companies where they had a physical restaurant location and now they're doing a sort of a massive takeout operation. They've scaled down staff so they can at least get break even on a cash flow basis so they can extend their lifespan. You know, you're looking at that. So how can I get, you know, the cash situation to a point where we're at least at break even? And then how do I get access to credit? And obviously the government's giving out, you know, credit that can be forgiven where you don't have to pay it back. So how do I use all these different instruments and tools to push out death as far as possible? Because the problem is right now, if you're a tax and accounting professional, you talk to a client, you got to be thinking, okay, is this business going to die in 1 month? Is this business going to die in 3 months? Is this business going to die in 9 months? Is this business going to die in 12 months? And I know you're thinking, I've had with some of my clients, you know, a lot of accountants are more conservative types. This thing's going to be over in a month, blah, 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 blah. You know what? Even if you think that's true, isn't it better to be prepared if it goes 12 to 18? Like, wouldn't we prefer that, you know, we were prepared for 12 to 18, but it only went 1 month. I know I'd prefer to be in that situation. And so these businesses have to think, am I prepared for 1 month? Am I prepared for three? Am I prepared for six? Am I prepared for 12? Am I prepared for 18? And so I think about all of the different things we need to do mainly on the balance sheet to strengthen that up. And some of these businesses are structurally, you know, the P&Ls are structurally destroyed. You're seeing, you know, if businesses have done worse through this and their sales are down 20 or 30%, that's good. You see people where sales are down 95, 100%. I mean, literally sales are down 95%. And so if they can do anything to start to generate something there and you can help them in that, that's great. But we've got to look at that balance sheet, got to look at the burn right now, got to look at how many days or months and how do we do everything in our power to help them extend that as long as possible, because we really don't know what's coming at this point.
what are the key government programs that accountants need to be tapping into now? And I know you keep tabs on them on a daily, hourly basis. How are they changing? And what comes next?
So, you know, obviously anything that I say in this video probably is going to be outdated by the time that we release it, because things are legitimately changing, you know, by the day. And they'll even change drastically on a Saturday or a Sunday. And so it's not even like, you know, oh, it's business hours. There's no business hours anymore. You know, I tell people like, oh, you know, oh, I got to go home. I got to stop this. What are you doing? You can't even go anywhere. It's like you should just get back to work, right? So we have people working around the clock on this stuff because there's nothing else to do. You're not going to go anywhere anyway. And so this stuff is coming out days, nights, weekends. And so, you know, right now, obviously, when I think about it, the government has done really three bills related to this, two kind of that really made an impact, but one major one, the CARES Act, right? So you've got the FFCRA or RCA, whatever it is, and then you've got the CARES Act, okay? In the CARES Act, obviously, everybody already knows about, if you're hearing some of this stuff for the first time and you're crawling out from under that rock, oh my gosh, you know, you need to go to our website as soon as possible and check out some of the stuff that we're doing, because this stuff has been huge. I've never seen the government, like, I was honestly shocked when I saw some of the stuff that they're coming out with. It's pretty insane. So they're obviously coming out with the Paycheck Protection Program, you know, the PPP 7A SBA forgivable loan. So a business owner can literally be lent money by the government. And as long as they spend that on qualified expenses, they don't need to pay it back. You know, when this whole thing was first starting, I knew that there would be some form of cash payments. I didn't know if it would be forgivable loans or if it would be grants, but they did forgivable loans. And those programs are coming in and out of appropriations. I think they approved $350 billion. They're in the process of approving another $310 billion. At least that's what's rumored to be coming out. But the reality of it is, if I make a prediction, I don't think that's going to be the last of it. I think you're going to continue to see more of these things because, you know, the government mandated closure of these businesses. And so that's what makes it a little bit different than normal. Like if it's a normal crisis where these people are bad at, nope, the government said, yeah, you have to go home. And so I think the government almost feels like guilty that they did this to these businesses, because some of these businesses would open. You see that in a lot of places where people are rioting. And I think that's, you know, continuing to get worse. You know, so obviously the Paycheck Protection Program. Now there's various intricacies with that, because there's some things you actually can't charge for if you're a tax and accounting professional helping them with this, but there's other things that you can't charge for. So you have to be really specific in what you're doing, what you're not doing. Then there's the EIDL, the disaster loans. And you know, that's basically, those are real loans. So those actually do have to be paid back, but there's a grant portion where you can get up to $10,000 per, you know, if you have, it's about $1,000 per employee. And you know, it's funny because when this thing has been going out, you've got the information in the bills. Then you've got the information on the website of the different government agencies, and then also the SBA, and like all of it's conflicting. And they even admit that. And they're like, oh, if you made a judgment based on some information that was conflicting and you don't have to change it, because this stuff is changing like crazy. And so we're monitoring any congressional sites, any Senate sites, we're monitoring the SBA site, any .gov domain is where we're looking. I'll tell you where you don't look. You don't look at Yahoo News. You know, you don't look at Fox News, because these journalists are just trying to pump out articles to get them. They're so wrong all the time, right? So we go to the .gov domains and we source things based on .gov, because at the end of the day, like, those are sometimes conflicting. But that, then you can make a judgment call at that point. And I give people the information and say, what can you do? So those are the two big lending options. And then in the CARES Act, there's obviously, you know, all sorts of other things, because if you don't get the loans, you do get the loans, you can defer payroll taxes. You can get, there's different payroll tax credits that have come out. And, you know, there's different things if employees are sick. So you can also, they've changed the NOL rules. So you can carry back 5 years for 18, 19, and 20. So there's all sorts of other tax planning opportunities. Some of them can be used in conjunction with the lending. Some of them need to be used only if you don't get the lending. And so I kind of look at it like, what are the lending consulting related opportunities? Some of that's from the legislation. Then there's also other things you could do outside of the new legislation that's come out. And then, okay, what are the tax credits and deferrals that you can get your clients, and how can we do NOL carrybacks and all the other goodies that they put in there? And so that's sort of the legislation consulting from the FFCRA and then also the CARES Act. And then there's going to be more. I mean, they say there's going to be another. I think people are not checking in with how big this thing is. There's going to be many things that happen from here, okay? So this is going to go on for quite some time, and I hope they don't blow it. Because, you know, if you think about, we're always helping business owners look at the balance sheet and the expenses and the inflow. I just worry about the government, right? Because if I'm looking at their balance sheet and their inflow and their expenses, they've blown this thing out, right? It would not look good. So, you know, those are kind of the two first pillars, the lending consulting that we're doing, and then also the legislation consulting. And then the third one is really cash management. So that's not from the government, but because the government has put all these programs out, like, actually figuring out how to manage cash given all these weird things. Like, how many times could you get a loan up to $10 million? You know, it's based on your payroll that you don't have to pay back. And then making sure. And so it's kind of, there were some of these things when they first came out, I started telling them to people. And when I would say it, I felt like I was saying something that was fake. Because 6 months ago, if I told you you could get money from the government, it was free, I'd sound like a fake person. They'd be like, that guy's saying fake things, right? But now this is literally the reality that we're living in, where these things are coming out that are so bizarre in a normal time, but were built for these extraordinary circumstances that these business owners cannot understand. I see people saying, oh yeah, tell the business owner to go do it on their own. I'm like, have you tried? How many of these have you done? It ain't exactly easy. And you know, there's all sorts of different judgments involved in. And what people don't understand is that the risk of getting it wrong is higher than it's ever been.
How do accountants need to change the way they think in order to do what's needed?
I think that, you know, we talk about this a lot in our company. The biggest problem is thinking that you are smart. Okay, all of us are a lot dumber than we think, myself included, right? We're all way dumber than we think. So, oh, I went to college and I got this degree and I have this experience and all, you know, and I have worked with this many clients and I've been in business this many years. Well, great. Well, when the government comes out with a new program that's never been done in a matter of days and businesses P&Ls go down 95%, you've never experienced this before. So all of that experience is not really relevant specifically to this. Now it helps to have it, but the people that are winning right now are the people I would say that really have two ways of thinking. And I talk about this with my team all the time. Number one, outlearn. So I have a mentality where I will outlearn you, right? You might know a lot of different things, but do you know the things that are relevant right now in the economy? And are you on the cutting edge? And are you waking up working 16, 18, 20 hour days to do it and to learn what's happening right now and what's working right now in this economy? Because this entire economy is being reshaped. So the way I think about it is, if you're willing to outlearn everybody else, you're going to come out on the other side of this thing, blowing them out of the water. You know, I did a case study the other day of like a prediction of the future, where if you're an accounting firm right now and you're doing 500,000 in sales and you go dormant, I'm going to take some time off. I'm going to go home and order margaritas and, you know, whatever. Your sales could drop 40 to 60% over the next 18 months. Okay. But if you're somebody that gets in the game, let's say you're doing 500,000 in sales, you're going to grow your business on the other side of this, because you're going to charge people a little bit to help them with all this stuff to help save their business and get out of this. On the other side, they're going to be eternally grateful. You're going to bring in so many clients that on the other side of this, when things return to normal, they're going to be with you. You're going to triple your business on the other side. So you can come out of this doing $1 million, $1.5 million if you're at 500,000, let's say. And so I'm constantly thinking about outlearning. And when the economy is being reshifted, I think that's a really valuable skill. If you have a mindset of, I don't know how to do the CARES Act, I don't know how to do SBA lending. I can tell you something. When I was sitting down over Christmas to do my vision board for 2020, I did not say, I want to start helping with SBA loans, right? Nobody did that crap, because no, that was not in my playbook, right? So the idea that you kind of plan, oh, well, I didn't do that. Well, I didn't plan on doing this either, okay? But this is a massive need for business owners. It's a massive need for tax and accounting professionals. And my mindset has always been, if I can outlearn you, then I can win. So the first pillar I would say is they need to think, how can they start to outlearn other people? Because, you know, if you think that the little 16 textbooks that we all learned in college are going to get you through this, you're not paying attention, okay? So outlearning is number one. Once you strap into that mentality of outlearning, then the second pillar I would say is outwork. Because if I can outlearn you and I can outwork you, it makes you very hard to beat. Makes you very hard. It's hard to lose in that kind of an environment, especially when the whole world is being reshaped. And I mean, there's so many different ways to think about how the world is being reshaped. I was watching an interview with Mark Cuban the other day, and he was talking about, they asked him, they said, you know, when are you going to reopen these NBA stadiums? And the reason I like this story is because so many people told me it clicked for them when the NBA canceled, right? That's when it clicked, right? That this was a big thing. And he said, they asked him, are we going to have NBA games again? Are we going to have social gatherings with everybody packing into stadiums? And he said, yes, we will. We will have that one day, but not for the next 12 months. And he said, imagine right now you go to a store, you try on clothes. You take those clothes, you put on those clothes, and then you don't want them. So you put them back. Is that okay? Is that an okay thing to do now? So I think when you start to understand that the world is going to be remade, reality is shifting and it is reinventing itself by the hour, you have to realize that the biases that you accumulated, the things that you believed, the way that you operated, the way that you helped are no longer relevant, because things are so different. than they were, and they're going to be more different on the other side. We're never going back to what we had. It will be new on the other side. It will not be the same. And so I think if you can adopt that mentality of outlearning, be on the cutting edge, and then you can add outworking, I think it's a dangerous combination.
The crash of 07 and the dot-com crash of 01, 02 each resulted in about 10% reduction in workforce in the tax and accounting industry, and took 3 to 7 years to recover. What are we looking at going forward today?
Yeah, so one of the key things I look at is the jobless claims, right? How many people have lost their job? Now, when we're shooting, at the time of shooting this video, I think since they really started closing down the economy, they've had a lot of job losses. Before this crisis, the most people that, you know, lost their job in a week was about 665,000 people. That was the record. Oh, 665,000 people lost their job in a week. That was terrible, okay? When this thing started, we have had the last 4 weeks, I believe it's 3.3 million, over 6 million, over 6 million, and 5.2 million. It's 20, 22 million jobs have been lost. It's probably a lot higher than that, because when you look, the unemployment sort of offices have wait times that are like days long. Okay, they're calling in day after. They can't even file for unemployment because the overwhelming demand. So people estimate unemployment is about 20% right now. What people don't understand is that the unemployment rate during the Great Depression, so 1933, peaked at 24.9%. I really don't think there's any way we're not going to go past that. Now, we're obviously in a weird situation, and people think, oh, well, you know, we're going to get this V-shaped recovery. So you're going to have this massive cut, but it's going to bounce back, and you're going to have this V-shape. And I've been asking people that a lot. You know, there's different ways to think about it. Do you have a V? Do you have a U where it takes some time? So do you have a V-shaped you know, bounce back? Do you have a U-shaped recession where it takes some time, but it does come back? Do you have an L-shaped depression? And then there's other ways to look at it too. Do you have a J, right? Or maybe do you have a check mark, right? There's different ways to think about these things, but I would say it doesn't really matter. You know, I don't care. I don't care if it's a U, I don't care if it's a V, I don't care if it's an L. The question is, what can I do regardless of what happens? And so I think that when you look at those jobless numbers, they're not going to go back quickly, okay? Because the fact that this event occurred means we're on very shaky ground. And so I just don't see any way that the unemployment is not going to be worse than the Great Depression. Now, does that mean that this will be as bad as everything during the Great Depression? I don't know. I really don't know. Like, the way my mind works is I know that most of these things I don't know. There's very few things that I know. I only know a couple of things, and even those things I only know with a certain degree of certainty. I'm like, I don't know anything. And so I don't know what's going to happen. I don't know where we're going from here. But I do know that there are a couple things in my life and in my business and in the business of my clients that if I focus on those things, I'm going to be happy no matter what the outcome is. I'm going to be happy with what I did, happy how I took action. And so I don't know how to predict these things. It looks like it's going to be just as bad, if not worse, than people think. But I also think that over the long term, things are going to be better. I do believe that. I do think that in the long run of my life, I think that the future is going to be greater than the past, but it really just matters. It just depends on how long that's going to take.
Among accounting and tax firms, there will be casualties. There will be winners. There will be losers. What will the business of accounting and tax practices look like at the other end of this?
Yeah, you know, it's a good question. And the way I think about it is that this entire world that we're now living in has started to crater in the last month, okay? And the devastating impacts of it are so massive that I don't actually think there's been enough days, enough hours, and enough minutes for me to spend on imagining all of the implications that are coming. So there hasn't been enough time for me to, especially because I've been working like crazy with all this stuff going on, there hasn't been enough time for me to sit back and think what is going to look like. And there's only been 1 month. I mean, and the changes are, these are like tectonic, you know, plate level shiftings in how things are working. So there's going to be all sorts of differences. I don't think people are going to be, obviously, you know, I think it was Morgan Stanley purchased 90,000 laptops in a week. So obviously that's a bank, but not all these numbers come out for all the accounting firms. They're not announcing this, but most accounting firms now are using laptops. But the point is that these are things where people are going to be working remote at a level that they never were before. And it's going to be accepted at a level that it never was before. It takes about 3 months for a human being to build a habit. This thing's going to go on longer than 3 months. People are going to be scared to go to an office for longer than 3 months. And so because of that, I think that we're probably never going to go back to the same kind of working that we did before. I think that the idea that you have a local focused business, the idea that you meet people in person, we haven't been doing that for years. I mean, we've been doing things on Zoom. We've been doing value deck presentations. We've been working with clients and collaborating remotely for years, but everybody's going to do that now. And it's like, it's no longer a choice. You've now been forced, right? Some of these people that had, you know, outdated systems, they really were scrambling during this. And so obviously people are going to be more remote. People are going to be hesitant to go in person. But I think even more than all of that, I think the biggest thing is just going to be, you know, the people that adapt and innovate are going to make it out of this thing in a way that the people that just want to do what they've always done. Like I talked to some of my clients, like, I liked my tax planning business. I miss it. I don't want to switch to this new stuff. I said, fine. But you know what? You're not guaranteed to survive. I said, if you think that you're guaranteed to have your tax planning business for real estate investors, and you think that you're somehow guaranteed that business or that somehow you deserve that business, wake up. No one cares about you. No one cares about your business. This thing is going down. And so unless you adapt and unless you innovate on new services, you'll just hit the slow bleed. Because I think people don't understand that I'm hoping that the most violent event has come with this whole transition thing. But I think the slow bleed is going to be worse than that violent transition in 1 month. So I think we're going to continue to get a slow bleed of like economic problems for months and months and maybe a year, 18 months. But these accounting firms, I don't think they're really prepared for that. They think, well, you know, a couple of clients canceled. And so like they're not preparing for the worst case scenario. And if you do that, you will slowly bleed out. The people that are adapting and innovating will be taking clients off of you. They will be rebuilding a business. They will come out on the other side of this with increase in revenue. They'll have hired the best people that you fired. They will have a strong balance sheet. They will have an income statement. They will have a story of success through this thing, as opposed to, oh, 2008 was so bad. I lost 70% of my business. Blah, blah, blah. But you hear these people, it's because they never changed. And so I think there's a good quote when this thing first started that I've always attached to. And I'm a relatively young guy, so I haven't had a chance to go through like 7 recessions like some people. And so, but it was this quote that whenever there's a dark age, there's always a golden age somewhere else. And so when this thing started, I started thinking, how can we switch? Because all the energy of the economy is going somewhere. It's going somewhere. And it's not in a stable place. It's not like, oh, it went to tax planning and tax prep, and now it's to PPP and EIDL. No, it's going to change again. And so the biggest thing I would say is I'm not going to predict what all these accounting firms are going to be like in a month from now. The only thing I can say is that if you have a mindset of adaptation, innovation, and reinvention constantly, I have a plan to reinvent my business every month through this thing. Every single month, I want to reinvent my business. New services, new value, new offerings, new message, new perspective. Every month, in the old world, you could get away with reinventing yourself and being an innovative company like every 6 months or a year. But that just doesn't fly anymore. Things are changing too quick. So you need constant reinvention. So if you're willing to innovate, you're willing to adapt, you're willing to reinvent yourself on a monthly or more basis, then I think you come out on the other side of this owning your space, whichever section of the industry that is.
You're talking about continuous reinvention, continuous innovation, continuous learning, continuous change. How is it possible for any firm or any accountant to possibly keep up with that?
I think the first thing you got to click into is gratitude. Okay, you're not running a dental practice right now where sales are down 90%. You're not, running a restaurant right now where you're completely out of business, okay? You're not a real estate agent where you're legally prohibited from showing houses. So I think the fact that you have to become a better version of yourself than you've ever been and you have to work your ass off to do it, shut up. That'd be my message, shut up. Okay. No one cares that you have a chance to actually save your business and grow. And it's going to be hard. It's going to be hard. And so I would tell anybody, I told all my team members, I call them team members, my full-time employees, we have 38 people. I told everybody in all my programs, I said, guess what? We've officially started a no complaint policy. So I know you're going through tough things. I know things are going bad, but if you think that you have a right to complain when you still have a job, and you still have a business, You're not paying attention to what's happening. And so I don't care how hard it is. I don't care how many hours you have to work. I don't care how crazy it gets. If you're a business owner and you're still in business, or if you're an employee and you still have a job, it's time to just shut up and get to work. And so the answer is, goes back to what I said earlier about outworking and outlearning, because, you know, people would kill to have the biggest problem in their business be, how do I keep up with all the changes to be able to grow my business? How do I keep up with all the changes I have to reinvent myself? If that's your problem, the only thing I can say is gratitude, because there are people out there that would kill to have that right now.
What does accountingtax.com do for CPAs?
Probably the best way for me to describe this is to tell you what we did before this whole crisis hit, and then it will show you kind of how we moved into this. My main focus and the way that I really measure the value of what we do is when an accountant sits down with a business owner, day one, you sit down with them, you analyze their income statement, you analyze their balance sheet. You also, I think, should take into consideration their personal income statement, their personal net worth statement. You should get an understanding of their total financial picture. In 12 months from now, does that person have a higher income or a higher net worth than they would have had if they didn't work with you? How are you making them more money? How are you protecting them? How are you growing their net worth? How are you growing their sales? How are you growing their income? And what are the services that we can offer to be an advisor to them? And not an advisor like, oh, I like to be an advisor and I like to look good and I like to tell them things. No, no, no. You need to make some people some, you need to get people some results. And you need to, number one, first and foremost, actually get them results. And that's when we did things like tax planning, CFO services before this, where you sit down with a business owner and, okay, you charge $750 to prepare a tax return. No, we don't do that. We charge $5,000, but we save the person $22,000 in taxes. That was what we did before, and we still do that. Obviously, incomes of the country fell off a cliff, if nobody noticed, right? So, okay, that's one thing that you do, right? But what are all the services that you can do to, basically, I say it free. I say, if a business owner works with you and it costs them anything, then you suck. You should provide them services where they're making an ROI, and they're actually making an ROI, number one. So they're actually making an ROI in reality. They have a stronger balance sheet, a stronger income statement as a result of working with you. Number two, you as the accountant know that, understand that, and believe in your value and can calculate your value. So you can calculate how much money you made them. You can calculate how much stronger financially they are. And you know that and you understand that. And number three, you show them that value. You actually have visual methods and detailed calculated methods to show them how much better they are with you than they would have been otherwise. And so many people are just like, they send out these reports that kind of look good, but they didn't work. And I can tell you right now in this new economy that we live in, with this whole COVID nightmare that we're all living in, there's never been a more important time where providing value is the only thing people are going to pay for. People aren't going to pay for anything anymore unless there's someone providing value. Like, bookkeeping is literally like a nice to have for many of these businesses. And you've seen that because they're just canceling like crazy. And so, you know, now coming into this COVID crisis, it's like, okay, great. Like, what can you do? What, when you sit down with this business, how can you strengthen the balance sheet? Is there anything we can do to rebuild the P&L? You know, you're going to have businesses through this thing where they had a full service, multiple Mexican restaurants. Okay. And now they realize, oh my gosh, that's not going to work. Because when we come back, restaurants are going to be 30% of capacity, even with all this stuff. So what are we going to do? Okay. Well, we want to rebuild our business into micro locations and takeout. And so they do that. They rebuild into micro locations. You help them build a new P&L. You help them do zero-based budgeting. You help them rebuild their cost structure from the ground up. They can produce enough revenue to cover expenses, make a profit, and maybe they expand. Maybe they take those micro locations and take out. They expand it across the country. Maybe they create one of the biggest franchises in 10 years from now because of your freaking engagement you work with them on how to reinvent their business, reinvent their cost structure, get to break even or better, and make it out of this mess, obviously taking into account all the government things as well. But I think the best way to explain it is, over the next year of somebody working with you, do you know you're providing value? And how can you prove that to me? How can you prove it to me? How can you specifically and in detail prove it to me? And can you prove it to me? Have you proved it to yourself? And have you shown it to the business owners? And so, yeah, we do marketing, we do sales, we do, you know, all the things related to practice development, growing the business, managing the workflow, hiring employees. We have a 12-month coaching program people come on for. We do some additional things related to COVID. We actually just launched our very first software product, which helps with agreements, engagement letters, and questionnaires. But fundamentally, the core value of what we do is, I think we understand, I don't want to say better than anyone because I don't know everyone, but better than most. I think better than most, we understand how to sit across from a business owner, actually create value, understand it, define it, and communicate that to them. And we understood how to do that before, and we reinvented ourselves and know how to do that now.
What haven't I asked that I should ask?
Throughout this whole experience of me building this business, I think that a lot of people, and you know, I can never really tell, like, if some of the hate that we get is because, you know, anytime you grow a business, you get a little bit of hate, right? And so I can never really tell if we get a little bit of hate because, oh, you know, you just grow and you get haters or whatever, or because there's a specific way that we've done things, you know, that, you know, maybe people don't like the style or whatever the case may be. And so I think we've been a little bit controversial, and I think, you know, I think that's an interesting question, is why? And that's the question that I ask myself a lot too. And the funny thing is like, I don't think we always do it intentionally. I think over time I've evolved and done different things. Like one of the things I used to say for years, which people think I invented, but you know, I don't think I invented this. I used to say a lot, I would say, you can be a successful tax and accounting firm owner, even if you don't have a CPA. Oh, that's crazy, that's crazy. And the funny part about that is I'm a CPA myself. And I actually used to think it was illegal to have an accounting business unless you had a CPA. But I discovered, because I met some amazing people, you know, beautiful, wonderful people that are my clients that don't even have a college degree, but have a $1 million tax firm. And so I had to discover that. And that really was one of my awakening points. And so I think asking, you know, why we've been controversial, I think it's because we've said some things that, while true, can be shocking to people. And
like,
you know,
what?
I'm exactly to that point. Like, you don't need to be a CPA to be successful. In fact, you don't even need to have had a college degree. Now, I'm not recommending that, right? I'm not recommending that don't go to college or don't get a CPA license. It's not a recommendation. It's just saying that if you don't have a CPA license, drop your freaking insecurity. If you have a tax business doing $250,000 a year and you want to go to $1 million and you don't have a college degree in accounting, drop your insecurity. And so it's an inspiring thing, because we all could have more. We all could have more than what we currently have. And so when I say those things, I think, you know, it freaks people out. But I've always played, and this goes down to this whole COVID thing as well, I always look at, you know, what are the things that are legal and that everybody approves of? There's sort of a we could put them all in a box, right? And then what are the things that are totally legal, but people don't think are legal? So for example, some people will say like, oh, you can't be a CPA and prepare taxes. Well, that's not true. You can prepare taxes even if you don't have a CPA license, okay? Now there's some state requirements, and we've done a state by state analysis, whatnot. But another one is, people said to me when we started this thing, you can't charge people for SBA loan consulting. Well, that's not true. There are some things you might have to follow. There are some things you can't charge for, but people hate it on me. And so I think that the main source of the controversy is that I look at .gov domains. I look at authoritative sources. I don't listen to people that have opinions. I listen to really three groups of people. I listen to, especially during this whole crisis, I listen to, and right now I'll say this, I listen to the medical experts, right? So the virologists, epidemiologists. I listen to billionaires because I think that they've done a good job of judging reality. That's how they've ended up where they've ended up. And I listen to policymakers. And I listen to policymakers because that gives us a sign of where things are going. So, you know, people want things to be a certain way. They, oh, well, you shouldn't charge clients. You can't charge for SBA loans. Or SBA loan consulting at all. You can't have an accounting firm unless you have a CPA. And so I think a lot of my controversy is that I'm not afraid to step outside the bounds of what people think is appropriate as long as it's allowed. And in that little area there is where I think there's a lot of opportunity, because a lot of other people stop there. They stay within the bounds of what people approve of rather than around the bounds of what's possible. And I think that greatly limits them. I always say that, you know, accountants, sometimes they can't dream outside of the cubicle they were born into. because they can't allow themselves to step outside and say, what's actually possible? What's actually allowed rather than what everybody told me? And I think when you do that, when you step out into that area and you start to ask, what is really possible for me? What is really allowed for me? It's far beyond anything you could have imagined in your previous mindset. And people that hate on it, I think, don't understand it. And I think people that hate on it, they don't talk to the wonderful people that have a $1.5 million tax practice and don't have a college degree. I mean, if you met this woman, you know, that I'm thinking of in my mind, one of my clients, I mean, who would hate on her? She's great. And so, you know, people just, you know, they get on Twitter, they get on the internet and they do their little thing. But I think the controversy thing is a piece of it. And, you know, it's something that I think we should do better at. I think it's a failure of communication on our part too. But I think that, you know, of some of the things you didn't ask, I think that'd be a good one. You know, it's like, why haven't we had more interviews like this? I think we haven't focused on it. We spent all the money we spend on advertising and everything, but we should do more things like this. I've enjoyed this. I think it's fun. And hopefully we'll do more in the future. I think you should talk to some of my clients. I mean, really, like, you know, some of the clients that I've had that I've worked with where, like, I had a woman who throughout this whole crisis, she probably dropped $50,000 a month in sales from the time that this thing started. And so, and people say, you can't charge people for this because their businesses are destroyed. I said, well, what do you say to an accountant that lost $50,000 a month in sales and had to fire 10 employees or 7 employees or whatever she had to lay them off? What do you say to her? Is she not allowed to charge anybody because she has to lay those people off? And so I think I have a client that I thought of off the top of my head. Her name's Rosa, where I don't know how much she lost in sales exactly, but it's probably over $50,000 a month. I don't know how many people she laid off, but it was probably over 7. But she reinvented her business through this and rebuilt her sales to where they're actually slightly above where they were before, but on completely new services. Now, I got a lot of other clients that have helped out in different ways, but I think that's a fascinating story of someone where their business completely collapsed. Because a lot of people don't think that. They think, oh, well, tax and accounting, well, we don't own a restaurant or whatever. But there are people with massive losses in sales, massive layoffs, but through a reinvention might actually end up better off on the other side than where they were before. And so I think those are some of the most inspiring stories of people that are out there actually doing it, making it happen, and have real results in this economy. I mean, can you imagine how you're going to feel 6 years from now when you stand on a stage and you tell that story and you hire back those people you had to lay off because you had the courage to reinvent yourself and do new things? And so I think you should interview some people like that, some of my clients, or if you find other people out there that have been able to reinvent themselves and be successful in spite of massive headwinds to their business, massive collapse in sales, layoffs, but build it all back even bigger than it was before.
Clearly, you're helping accountants do better work for their clients, which is really what it's all about.
Thanks. I appreciate it, Rick.
Thank you, Andrew. Have a good day.